بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والعاقبة للمتقين، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا، وانفعنا بما علمتنا، وزدنا علما. سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا، إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. يقول الله تعالى في كلامه المجيد: يا أيها الذين آمنوا أطيعوا الله وأطيعوا الرسول وأولي الأمر منكم، فإن تنازعتم في شيء فردوه إلى الله والرسول. وقال النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام فيما روى عنه الإمام البخاري في صحيحه: السمع والطاعة حق على مسلم ما لم يؤمر بمعصية، فإذا أمر بمعصية فلا سمع ولا طاعة، أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام. أستاذ برادرز أند إلدرز، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. As you may be aware that we have this great controversy and issue of removing of hijab in France, as you all may have heard about it. Today, inshallah, I would like to talk about this subject and what understanding a Muslim should have with regards to this issue, and what are the responsibilities and duties for a Muslim. As you know, that hijab, which is the covering of the head, we have hijab and we have niqab. Hijab is the covering of the head. Niqab is the covering of the face, which is a totally different issue altogether. Hijab is the covering of the head, which is something not just a symbol of Islam. It is from the Sha'a'ir. Sha'a'ir means the features, the salient features of Islam, which is, it is something which is unanimously agreed upon by the whole of the Ummah. All the Muslim ulama scholars, never has there been any difference of opinion regarding it. It's just like the fardiyya and the obligation of prayer. It is the fundamental part of our religion. Some ulama have stated and have gone so further to say that hijab and dress and libas is the most important thing after iman, after having belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it has been something which has been prescribed in every prophet Ummah before the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet of Isa alayhi salam, and Musa alayhi salam, and all other prophets before that, and so much so that it was the first thing. When, as you know, the story of Sayyidina Adam alayhi salatu wa salam and his wife Sayyida Hawa alayhi salam, when they were in Jannah, in paradise, and when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when they ate from the forbidden fruit from the tree, the clothes were removed and they started covering their awrah, they started covering their nakedness and concealing it. So the human being has been created on this modesty, on shame. As Allah says, يَا بَنِيَ آدَمَ قَدْ أَنزَلْنَا عَلَيْكُمْ لِبَاسٍ يُوَارِي سَوْآتِكُمْ وَرِيشًا. We have descended upon you, revealed upon you, and we have given you a libas, a clothing. يُوَارِي سَوْآتِكُمْ. It covers, conceals and hides your nakedness, your awrah and your shame. وَلِبَاسِ تَقْوَى ذَلِكَ خَيْرٍ. So it's been something which has been prescribed in the Ummah, in the deen of every prophet since Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam all the way to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Some people say that it's libas and the covering or the clothing is an outwardly thing. It's got nothing to do with your inside. If your inside is good, if your ruh, spiritually you are pious and spiritually you are practicing the implementing the laws of Islam, outwardly it does not matter. Regardless, this is totally un-Islamic and totally incorrect, because Allah says وَذَرُوا رَاهِرَ الْإِثْمِ وَبَاطِنَهُ, that leave and abstain and stay away from sins that are connected to your outward and to your internal sins and the outward sins. Both, refrain from both of them. Just as we are obliged and we are responsible to be internally and spiritually cleanse ourselves and we have this connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, similarly outwardly we have obligations, we have duties, we have responsibilities which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us. So libas and the covering is one of the fundamentals. It's from the sha'air, as I mentioned. Sha'air means the salient features of Islam. One of the salient features. Allah says, وَمَنْ يُعَظِّمْ شَعَائِرَ اللَّهِ فَإِنَّهَا مِنْ تَقْوَى الْقُلُوبِ. The one who respects these features of Islam, then this is from the taqwa, from the piety of the heart. So it's one of the most important things. As some ulama have stated that, as I said, that after belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after iman, the most important thing is the libas, the covering
also human being, whether it's a male or a female. The aura, as you know, the aura, which is the nakedness, translated as nakedness in English, the part of the body which must be concealed, which must be hidden. For a man, it's from the navel, from underneath the navel, up to and including the knees. The knees are also included. And for a woman, it's the whole body, the aura. Remember what I'm saying? I'm saying the aura, which is the nakedness, which must be covered at all times, according to all the ulama and the whole ummah, it is the whole body except for the hands, which is up to the wrist, the feet, up to the ankles, and the face. These three are not considered to be part of awrah. This is according to the whole ummah. Then the face, ulama has stated that you have to cover it, not because it is awrah, but because of fitna, etc. That's a whole total different subject altogether, and a separate talk on that. But the awrah of a woman, the nakedness of the woman, which must be totally, completely covered at all times, is that the whole body besides the hands, and remember, hands is just up to the wrist. Above the wrist, the arms is part of the nakedness. She must cover it. If she puts her sleeves up, then this is totally haram and lawful. If a woman raises slightly her trousers or her garment above her ankles and shows and exposes it, this is totally unlawful haram also, according to the ijma', the consensus of the whole ummah. Unanimously, the whole ummah has agreed upon this. And also, the hair. The face is just from the top of from the top of the forehead until the chin, and from one earlobe to the other earlobe. Besides that, it is awrah, which must be definitely, completely, totally, absolutely covered, and there's no way whatsoever she can expose it and open it. So there's a lot of importance of this, and I don't want to go into this, as we all know that this is part of Islam, and I'm not here to, you know, give you dalils and proofs, because it is something agreed upon, accepted by everybody. Nobody has ever come in Islamic history saying that, no, you don't have to cover the head. Nobody. We've had differences of opinion between the ulama stating the face, should you cover or not cover? I mean, is it necessary to cover or not necessary to cover? We've had debates and disputes and ikhtilaf, which is differences of opinion with respect, of course. That's happened, but nobody has ever disputed the fact that covering of the hair is an absolute necessity. There's no way whatsoever that you can keep your hair open. Now, in such a case, it's similar to the performing an offering of prayer. It's similar of keeping a fast in the month of Ramadan. It is similar to performing Hajj. It is similar to other aspects of your deen and of your religion. And it is similar to all of this. In such a case, what happens if somebody orders you to do something? As you know, normally, when a person lives in a country, explicitly or implicitly, he signs an ahd, a covenant, or a treaty, or he agrees that he will abide by the laws of the country. Explicitly, which is understandable, and implicitly, meaning by him living in that country, he accepts that he will abide by the laws of the country. Whether that is an Islamic country or a non-Islamic country, a Muslim country or a non-Muslim country, an Islamic country or a secular country, and even nowadays only the Muslim governments are all secular or whatever. But you abide by the laws of the country. And this has been clearly in the mention as a verse of the Quran which I recited in front of you also. Allah says, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu abi'u Allah. O you who believe, O Muslims, O believers, obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, wa abi'u Rasul, and also after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because we obey Allah because He is our Lord, He is our Creator, we have to obey Him. And He is the only being worthy of being worshipped and obeying. And then after that, Allah says, وَأَتِيعُ الرَّسُولِ, that obey and follow the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why? Because he is the messenger of Allah. He is bringing the laws and he is mentioning to us and guiding us, and he is giving us the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So in order to follow Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we follow the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then Allah says, وَأُولِي الْأَمْرِ مِنْكُمْ, that obey the rulers, أُولِي الْأَمْرِ, the people of authority amongst you. This is a general term which some have stated that it means, and it means a lot of things. It means the people of authority are the people who rule you, people who are ulama, scholars, people who are mujtahidun, etc. All of them are included. وَأُولِي الْأَمْرِ مِنْكُمْ, then follow them. Why do you follow them? Because, and only because. You follow them only because, just as we follow the messenger of Allah, only and merely because he is giving us the message from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we follow the people of authority now amongst us with the sole reason that he or that person is delivering the message of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Al-ulama warathatul anbiya, as you know, that the ulama and the scholars are the inheritors of the anbiya, the prophets. Why do we follow them? Why do we follow the mujtahideen? Why do we follow the people of authority? Because they are simply conveying the message from the Messenger of Allah. If somebody is in authority, but if it's not conveying the message of the Messenger of Allah and the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَإِنْدَ نَازَعْتُمْ فِي شَيْءٍ, if there's a dispute amongst you, Allah says further along in that verse, فَرُدُّوهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولٍ, that then you must return to Allah and the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Which means that if there's people of authority amongst you, normally in Muslim countries as well as in non-Muslim countries, the general rule is that you have to obey by the law of the land. This is a general understanding of the ulama, that you have to obey the laws of the land, whether you're in an Islamic country or even in a non-Muslim country, because in a non-Muslim country you are agreeing by living there, you are agreeing and signing an agreement, whether I said it explicitly or implicitly. There's a covenant, ahad, which has taken place. Allah says, وَأَوْفُوا بِالْأَحَدِ, that fulfill your promises and fulfill the covenants which you make. وَأَوْفُوا بِالْأَحَدِ إِنَّ الْأَحْدَ كَانَ مَسْئُولًا. So because of that, if you live in a country, you fulfill and you obey the laws of the land. You have to obey the laws of the land. For example, the ulama have stated that if there are laws carried out, or if there are laws of the land, like for example, in this country, we have the law of stopping at the traffic light when it's red. Now from an Islamic, from a Sharia perspective, if somebody was to go through red light, you'll be sinful according to Islam also. If the law says that 70 miles per hour is on the motorway, if you are going and speeding above 70, you are sinful from an Islamic perspective also. This, many, many scholars and ulama have taken this. Because it's an ahad, it's an agreement you've taken with the government, with the people of authority, and you must obey by the law of the land. So if you go above 70, now here there's a different aspect also, that there are sometimes there's a leeway, like for example, until 80, 85 miles per hour, normally it is understood that nothing happens. They put 70 miles per hour, but they know people speed to 75, 80, 85, and nothing really happens. If that's understood, then you have a leeway and there's a concession that you can at least, you know, go to that level of speeding. But something which you get arrested upon. And also another reason for it to be impermissible is that disgracing your own self is also not permissible in Islam. The ulama has stated, to put your own self in disgrace, to put your own self in a position that you will be arrested, you will be disgraced. A Muslim should not put his own self to be disgraced. A Muslim, especially if it's a religious, pious Muslim who is a practicing Muslim, and he is speeding, and then the police come up to him and he's in the middle of the road, and then the next minute he has to come here and give a talk, and you know, and people will say and see him on the road, which is disrespectful, of course, and disgracing him. So you should do things which are not disrespectful and disgraceful to yourself. So that's another aspect also. So the laws of the land, they must be abided by. We have to obey by the laws of the land wherever we are. But the condition is, as in the hadith which I just quoted in the beginning, where Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, the son of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he narrates that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, he said, السَّمْعُ وَطَاعَ مَا لَمْ يُؤْمَرْ بِمَعْصِيَةٍ, that there is adherence, there is listening, there is obedience, meaning you must obey, you must listen, you must adhere, obedience to the people of authority, the people of law and the government, etc., wherever you are. مَا لَمْ يُؤْمَرْ بِمَعْصِيَةٍ, as long as you are not ordered to do something which is a sin, as long as you are not ordered to do something which is contrary and against the teachings of Sharia, against the teachings of the Quran and Sunnah, against the teachings of Islam. مَا لَمْ يُؤْمَرْ بِمَعْصِيَةٍ فَإِذَا أُمِرَ بِمَعْصِيَةٍ فَلَا سَمْعَ وَلَا طَاعَةٍ, that if you are ordered to do something which is against Islam, which is against religion, and to the level of something which is a saving feature, a sha'a'ir from the sha'a'ir of Islam, and as I mentioned, the importance of hijab, if it's to that level, then of course, فَلَا سَمْعَ وَلَا طَاعَةٍ, there is no listening, there is no obedience, there is no adherence to these laws, because we have a right to practice our own deen, our own the injunctions of Quran and Sunnah. In another hadith narrated, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, لَا طَاعَةَ لِمَخْلُوقٍ فِي مَعْصِيَةِ الْخَالِقِ, there is no obedience to the creation There is no obedience to the creation whereby there is disobedience to the creator, which is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you must obey by the laws of the land as long as it does not order you to do something which is haram, something which is going against your deen, something which is going against your principles, something which is against your understanding of Quran and Sunnah, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala orders and informs you. And some people say that it's, and recently people have been stating this, that it's an internal thing. The government has a right to do whatever they want to do. If they make laws, it's a non-Islamic country, then they can make laws. It's an internal affair, and Muslims should abide by it. And so much so that you must have heard that one of the scholars also mentioned it. And he was refuted by the majority of the ulama of the world. I discussed this with a lot of scholars, not just here, not just in outside England. I also, one of my friends mentioned to me, who lives in Jordan, that many ulama in Syria, in Jordan, and many other Muslim countries, and of course in the Indian subcontinent, if it's condemned in the Arab world, then it's most definitely going to be condemned in the Indian subcontinent, because they are normally more harsher in these matters, or more harsh in these matters. In the Islamic countries as well, the Arab countries, people, the ulama in Saudi, the ulama in Syria, in Jordan, many places, they totally condemned one of the so-called scholars, who said that no, they have the right, the French government has the right to ban it, and Muslim sisters should discard the scarves, and it's no problem whatsoever. This is an internal thing. If it's an internal thing, then everything becomes internal. The massacre of Muslims taking place in Palestine, of the Jews killing innocent Muslims, leave it, it's internal affair. It's their internal affair. We have no right to go and interfere. If that's the case. If that was the case, then what happened in Russia, in the former USSR, where on the name of communism and on the name of banning religion, they burnt the copies of the Quran, of the Mus'haf, and they also demolished the masajid, the houses of worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You could have said, this is an internal affair, this is their government, that's their laws, they can demolish the masjid if they want, no problem. If they want to burn all the Quran and all the masahif and all the religious books, it's an internal affair, it's their government, it's their country, they can do whatever they want to do. This is totally an Islamic. Allah says, in the Quran, كُنْتُمْ خَيْرَ أُمَّةٍ أُخْرِجَتْ لِلنَّاسِ تَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَتَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. So you are ordered to enjoy the good and forbid the evil. If we take this out, that this internal affair, let them do whatever they do, then this ayah and this verse of the Quran goes totally out of the window. That you should order and enjoy the good, and if there's an evil taking place, then you have to raise your opinion, you have to raise your voice. In the hadith, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stated, مَنْ رَآ مِنْكُمْ مُنْكَرًا فَلْيُغَيِّرْهُ بِيَدِهِ. Whoever sees in front of you, one of you, whoever, a Muslim, when you see something evil, مَنْ رَآ مِنْكُمْ مُنْكَرًا فَلْيُغَيِّرْهُ بِيَدِهِ, then you must change it. You must do something by changing this with your hand. فَإِنَّمْ يَسْتَطِعْ, if you are not able to do so, then فَبِلِسَانِ, then with your tongue, raise your voice with your tongue, and do something to change that evil taking place before you with your tongue. فَإِنَّمْ يَسْتَطِعْ فَبِقَلْبِهِ, if you are not able to do it, neither with your hand, neither with your tongue, then you must do the, you must, the last stage or the last status is فَبِقَلْبِهِ, that you at least think of it to be evil, think of it to be bad in your heart. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that وَذَٰلِكَ أَضْعَفُ الْإِيمَانِ, that this last level, you are not able to change it with your hand, you are not able to change it with your mouth, you just thought of it to be evil in your heart, then this is the weakest level of iman. وَذَٰلِكَ أَضْعَفُ الْإِيمَانِ. So you have to do something. So this is something which is totally Islamic. We should do whatever. Today they're saying that it's going to happen in France, and the funny part is that the whole government of France, they are trembling in front of just a headscarf. You know, there's this Islamophobia, as you know, that they're scared of Islam wherever, in most of the Western countries. So even a headscarf is making them scared. But it's today, it's in France, and whatever the reason behind them trying to do this, we don't know the intention, we don't know what the motives are, we don't know. But whatever, it could be tomorrow, it could be here, it could be other places, then it could be in the Islamic countries, we don't know. It could be anywhere in the world. If we are just going to stay quiet and say this is an internal affair, this is their government policy, we don't do nothing, then tomorrow they'll say that, okay, we're going to ban all the Quran. There's no message, you can't build any message in France. You can't keep any Quran. And it's happened, one case where some Muslims, they had a Quran in their house, and people they were arrested because they had a Quran in where they were converted, and they opened the Quran and there was an English translation, and the people came to arrest them. They said, look, you've got this. This is our Quran which we recite. There's nothing to do with no, this. It's a verse which is blasphemous and it causes racial hatred, whatever, or etc. So tomorrow they'll say that ban all the Quran. This is our right. We as Muslims, we have a right to practice our deen. We have a right to practice the laws and ahkam of Sharia. And we must do something about it. As far as the other aspect is concerned, where people say that you have to go is it jihad and go in jihad. No, no, no. Despite saying all of this, you have to keep a cool head. You have to have patience. You have to have sabr. Use the lawful means. You don't go and start killing everybody and causing havoc and things like that. No. You use the lawful means. The right which you have, you use that in a nice way, gentle way, polite way, kind manner. You use it properly, with respect, with others. You don't become crazy, because this is sometimes what happens in the Muslims. When something happens, people become crazy, and that craziness and that surge which happens, it lasts for 1 week, and then as the fizz of the cold goes away, everything goes away. You see, once the Salman Rushdie affair came, people went onto the streets, and I don't know what happened. People were saying, kill him, and this and that, and then suddenly, we've not heard anything about him. As you know, that he's visiting India at the moment. He's in India right now, where there's so many Muslims there, and he's visiting, you know, and he stays in the hotel, and he's got protection and guards, and he's enjoying life. There's nobody to say anything to him. Everybody's Muslims probably have even forgotten. Even the new generation, they don't probably even remember who Salman Rushdie was. That 1 week of uproar and that 1 week which people had is gone out of the window. So we do it, it's consistent, and you have to sustain it. But do it with a level mind, with a cool mind, not just become crazy and say, declare war on France and that's it, kill all the kuffar and things like that. No. You have to be calm, in a composed, calm manner, use the local means, and inshallah, if you try this, inshallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will pray to Allah as well that you remove these kind of difficulties from the Muslims. I end with this, inshallah, just one or two things to remind you. One is, of course, as you know, that we are coming to the, we are in the Hajj and the days of Eid and Hajj are coming, etc. One of the important things is on Hiyya, which is the ritual slaughter or the sacrifice which is given. So just reminding the brothers that this is a responsibility, according to the majority of the ulama, it is a wajib, a necessary responsibility. Some have said it's sunnah, but even those ulama who say it's sunnah, they say sunnah mu'akkada, one of the most emphasized sunnah. And majority of the ulama say it's wajib, especially in the Hanafi madhab, it's totally wajib. Every individual who is mature, reached the level of age of puberty, and he has within his ownership, on that particular day of Eid, on that particular day, if he has in his ownership approximately, which is 613 grams of silver, which is approximately, I don't know how many, 60-70 pounds, the nisab of zakat, then he or she, every single individual must sacrifice and give money for the slaughter of an animal, for the sacrifice which is known as udhiyah. It is very necessary. It's not one individual of the family or the father does it on everybody's behalf. No. Every individual is responsible. It's like your own prayer. Your father doesn't pray the salah for your fajr, ruha, al-asr for you. It's just like that. Individually on everybody. Yes, if somebody wants to give it on your behalf and you accept it, it's like he's giving you the money as a gift and then he's doing it. Then that's another case. But you must, a separate one must be done on each person's behalf. And if there's large animals, then you can, like a camel, etc., you can make seven parts, seven people can share the animal. If it's the small animals, then one per head. So this is important on Eid al-Adha, where we have this udhiyah, also known in Urdu as qurban. So this is very important, and there are a lot of ahkam and rules relating to these particular few days, but I didn't want to talk about that because I think last year I talked about the same issue, and there's a lot of articles on that particular, on that page down there on the table. There's leaflets, there's a book on qurban as well, and there's a newsletter also, and this is, all of them are to do with the same. Inshallah, if people can take that, that'll be very beneficial. And another announcement which I wanted to make, this is a personal thing, but on every, there's a poster there as well, which says weekly lessons on in Hanafi fiqh, which I have every Friday, which is a lesson, just about half an hour, 40 minutes, 45 minutes at most, every Friday after Isha prayer, in English, in Masjid al-Jami', in Arabic you would say Al-Masjid al-Jami', even though people say Jami' Mosque, which is Al-Jami' with a Ayn at the end. And in Arabic, you have, as you know, it's opposite. Well, no, in English is opposite. In the other language is opposite. The right way is in the Arabic way, which is Al-Masjid Al-Jami', which is an Ashabi street. So after Isha prayer, which is 8:15 every Friday, it's been going on for around 1 year, where we have lessons in Hanafi fiqh, which we started from the chapter of purity, from all the way from tayammum, from wudu and ghusl, bath, etc., and leather socks, and went on to the women issues like menstruation, and covered it in about approximately 1.5 years in detail. We started the chapter on prayer, which is in the beginning and initial stages. And now what the intention is that every month, the first 2 weeks could carry on from the chapter of prayer and salah, where we're carrying on, we just carry on from there. The third and the fourth week, which is probably more interesting, is that I'm going to start, inshallah, on the chapter of marriage. So the third and first and second week will be carrying on with the same salah. And the third week and the fourth week of every month will be starting from the chapter of marriage, which means marriage and divorce, etc., and carries on. There's a lot of ahkam, and you need to know about it. This is according to the Hanafi mazhab. And you can learn about the Shafi'i, Maliki, Hanbali, but this is specifically. And also sometimes I do mention other mazahib. It's not just restricted just to the Hanafi mazhab. Inshallah, brothers can attend it. And for the sisters, I mean, this is unfortunately, there's lack of facilities only for brothers. But the sisters can, I think, listen into the receiver. I don't know the frequency number, but I think it's written, inshallah. I mean, this is Rahul Zahman, alhamdulillah.
Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Shalom.
حمدا يوافي نعمه ويكافئ مزيده. يا ربنا لك الحمد كما ينبغي لجلال وجهك ولعظيم سلطانك. سبحانك اللهم لا نحصي ثناء عليك انت كما اثنيت على نفسك. واشهد ان لا اله الا الله وحده لا شريك له. واشهد ان سيدنا ونبينا واسوتنا وقائدنا محمد بن عبد الله. أشهد أنه محمد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وبارك وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد صلاة وسلاما دائمين متلازمين إلى يوم الدين. وأوصيكم أيها المسلمون ونفسي المذنبة بتقوى الله تعالى. أما بعد فيا عباد الله، إن الله تعالى قد أمرنا في كتابه الكريم فقال عز من قائل عليما: يا أيها الذين آمنوا أطيعوا الله وأطيعوا الرسول وأولي الأمر منكم فإن تنازعتم في شيء فردوه إلى الله والرسول. فأمرنا الله تعالى أن نطيعه ثم بعد ذلك أمرنا أن نطيع رسوله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم. فإطاعة رسوله من أجل أن نطيع الله عز وجل. ثم بعد ذلك أمرنا الله تعالى أن نطيع أولي الأمر، أولي الأمر منا وهم أصحاب الدولة أو أهل الاجتهاد المجتهدون، فيجب علينا أن نطيعه أيضا، ولكن هذا أيضا معلق من أجل أن نطيع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. فإذا أمرنا أحد من أولي الأمر شيء يعارض ويخالف أمر الله ورسوله فلا سمع ولا طاعة، كما قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فيما روى عنه سيدنا عبد الله بن عمر رضي الله عنه الذي أخرجه الإمام البخاري في صحيحه: السمع والطاعة حق ما لم يؤمر بمعصية، فإذا أمر بمعصية فلا سمع ولا طاعة. وقال عليه الصلاة والسلام أيضا: لا طاعة لمخلوق في معصية الخالق. فإذا نرى شيئا منكرا أمامنا يعارض ويخالف أمر الله ورسوله في كتابه وسنة رسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم، فيجب علينا أن نعارضه ونقابله ونرفع أصواتنا ضده، كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام: من رأى منكم منكرا فليغيره بيده، فإن لم يستطع فبلسانه، فإن لم يستطع فبقلبه، وذلك أضعف الإيمان. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين، فاستغفروا إنه الغفور. الحمد لله، الحمد لله حمدا كثيرا كما أمر، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله تعالى عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وبارك وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا. أما بعد، فيا عباد الله اتقوا الله فيما أمر، وانتهوا عنه عما نهى عنه وزجر، وأخرجوا حب الدنيا من قلوبكم فإنه إذا استولى أثر. واعلموا أن الله تعالى قد أمركم بشيء بدأ فيه بنفسه، فقال عز من قائل عليما: إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي، يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. وارض اللهم عن الخلفاء الراشدين أبي بكر وعمر وعثمان وعلي، وعن سائر الصحابة والتابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. اللهم اغفر المؤمنين والمؤمنات والمسلمين والمسلمات الأحياء منهم والأموات، إنك سميع قريب مجيب الدعوات. اللهم إنا نسألك موجبات رحمتك وعزائم مغفرتك والغنيمة من كل بر والسلامة من كل إثم والفوز بالجنة والنجاة من النار. لا تدع لنا ذنبا إلا غفرته، ولا هما إلا فرجته، ولا حاجة من حوائج الدنيا هي لك رضا ولنا فيها صلاح إلا قضيتها ويسرتها، يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم إنك عفو كريم رحيم تحب العفو فاعف عنا. اللهم انصر الإسلام والمسلمين، اللهم انصرهم على عدوك وعدوهم يا رب العالمين. ربنا اغفر لنا ولوالدينا ولمشايخنا ولأساتذتنا ولأرباب الحقوق علينا والإخوان الحاضرين، والحمد لله رب العالمين. عباد الله رحمكم الله، إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. اذكروا الله يذكركم وادعوه يستجب لكم، ولذكر الله أكبر، والله يعلم ما تصنعون. وأقيموا الصلاة.
الله أكبر، الله أكبر، لا إله إلا الله، أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله. حي على الصلاة، حي على الفلاح، قد قامت الصلاة، قد قامت الصلاة. الله أكبر، الله أكبر، لا إله إلا الله،
لا إله إلا الله. استوى استقيم واعتدل فكم straight in the road إن شاء الله، complete the road إن شاء الله. The space in the road before you, it is wrong to start a new road. Allahu Akbar. I
الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. آمن الرسول بما أنزل إليه من ربه والمؤمنون كل آمن بالله وملائكته وكتبه ورسله لا نفرق بين أحد من رسله وقالوا سمعنا وأطعنا غفرانك ربنا وإليك المصير لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها لها ما كسبت وعليها ما اكتسبت ربنا لا تؤاخذنا إن نسينا أو أخطأنا ربنا ولا تحمل علينا إصرا كما حملته على الذين من قبلنا ربنا ولا تحملنا ما لا طاقة لنا به واعف عنا واغفر لنا وارحمنا أنت مولانا فانصرنا على القوم الكافرين.
الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر.
الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. القارعة ما القارعة وما أدراك ما القارعة يوم يكون الناس كالفراش المبثوث وتكون الجبال كالعهن المنفوش فأما من ثقلت موازينه فهو في عيشة راضية وأما من خفت موازينه فأمه هاوية وما أدراك ما هي نار حامية.
الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الحمد لله. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله.
استغفر الله.